Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Good morning and a warm welcome to everyone. I am Manu Kashyap from Advaita Academy. I welcome you all to yet another session of Conversations on Consciousness. Let me begin with a small prayer. Sarvatma sarvadrugyosau sarvadhyasa nirasakrit satatam sannidhattam me hridaye paramashivah. Today, we have a very special guest all the way joining from Australia. Swami Paramananda Saraswati ji, pronounced to you, Swami ji. He's also president of Yoga Vedanta Association, Australia. For the benefit of our viewers, I would like to introduce Swami ji to our audience. Inspired by various masters and under the guidance of Swami Anubhavananda ji, who himself is a disciple of Gurudeva Pujya Swami Chinmayananda ji, Swami ji has studied the ancient scriptures and is able to share them with straightforward clarity. He travels widely sharing his knowledge on Bhagavad Gita, Patanjali Yoga Sutra, Panchadashi, Vedas, Upanishads, and various texts written by ancient and modern masters. Over the last 19 years, Swamiji has dedicated himself to the pursuit of sharing of the vast bounty of Vedanta. Thank you once again, Swamiji, for joining us. Without much delay, I would like to start with the questions. Swamiji, we ask all the teachers who join us the same question, that is, how did you develop your initial interest in Vedanta? How did it all start? Could you please share with us?
Without going too much in the past, and thank you for inviting me, first of all, and that traveling all over the world, that is no longer valid. 19 years has become 22 years now. So that is an old information. From childhood, when I was 10, 11 years old, 12 years old, there, while reading Amar Chitra Katha under a Parijat tree in the school holidays, and I borrowed it from my friends and just keep reading all the Mahabharata, Ramayana, the various characters. And that time, one day, I had to finish it because that fellow will come and take it within one day or 2 days. And I've got involved in it so much that I slept on the scooter. And while sleeping or meditating, I don't know. And in that, one thing became clear. It's still very distinctly clear that what is the purpose of life? Because every story you read, every king is leaving their kingdom and taking to sannyas. Every rishi is only meditating. They don't want anything from the world. And it clicked that day as a child that the purpose of life is moksha. What is moksha? I had no idea. But it is moksha. And it went deep inside. Any time throughout the life, when life took me here, there, whenever I used to reassess where I am today, or difficulties came in my life, and I will say, or if I'm running after something too much with full zest and inspiration, suddenly checking will be happen, or assessment will happen. Is this what my purpose of life is? No. Okay, drop it. And eventually it brought me to yoga and then japa and sadhana. So for many, many years, at almost from age 20 to 32 till I went to the ashram to study with Swamiji. Say, there you go. It's 12 years. They say to, I didn't know 12 years is the sadhana period, but that was the sadhana period for me, in which I went through lots of ups and downs and it all began with an out-of-body experience, and then who is this fellow? And I used to come out of the body not to do sadhana, but to do more overtime. I used to get energized with that. And all those are experimental stages, and eventually it led to where I am today. Still, journey is going on.
If I may ask, where did your schooling and college happen?
Why you are going into the past?
Okay, Swamiji, I apologize for that. Yeah. So, how did your introduction to Swami Chinmayananda happen? How did Chinmaya Mission happen? Who were your gurus and how did Swami Anubhavananda ji influence your life?
Yes. I was in, I migrated to Australia after a stint in Middle East and Europe, and then I came to Australia. My parents were here. And actually, I was doing my sadhana and whatever I understood, and no guru, no books, but just the breath. And and eventually many things happened, which I will not go into. But when I came here, my mom's father, he was sitting one day in meditation. He was a yogi of 40 years. He was sitting, and I was about to go to work, and I was having my coffee, and I was watching him sitting in front of the heater. And he didn't even complete the three ohms, and he was in meditation. So I said, this old man, 82 years old, is he sitting and sleeping, or what is he doing? You know, young mind. So I went and plucked a hair, put it under his nostrils. It hardly moved. Then I took the courage and put my hand on his heart. No heartbeat. 82 years old. Then he didn't even react. I called my work that I'm taking a day off. And when he came out of meditation, I asked him, where were you? I want to go there. And then a renewed, focused, guided journey began. And that happened for 2 years. That day itself, he initiated me into the breathing exercise, certain count of breath to rekindle where I had stopped some 2 years ago or 3 years ago. And then very quickly, within 2 years, 3 years, so many masters were coming to Melbourne. Buddhist monks, Taoist monks, Indian sadhus, Kundalini masters, which I never knew of. And, you know, when you are ready, then, as they say, the teachers come. Wherever I was stuck, I used to go to them. I used to listen to them. Someone would be translating them. And every teacher, he used to call me and initiate me without me asking them. I said, I didn't understand what was going on, but it is okay. They used to give me some mantra. I used to chant for some time, and it used to then go away. But it was probably required at that time. And eventually, I was at home, and a point came wherein, with lot of Kundalini sadhana chant, no Vedanta till now. No Vedanta at all. But I was doing a lot of breath control and single-pointed exercises. And that used to lead me into meditation, and all my vices went away. Whatever the bad habits are there for any youth, so to speak. And I used to go to work. And whenever I'm doing my sadhana, I used to think that I have reached the peak. This is what moksha is, because it felt that way. And then I will stop doing, because it used to be exhausting, because these exercises like pranayama, they exhaust you, and then you have to go to work. And so I used to stop, and then the vices will come back, bad habits will come back. Then again, I'll try it. Again, I'll begin. Again, they will go away. So this happened for almost 1.5 years or so. But it took me that long to catch that, hey, I'm caught in a pattern. I'm doing the same thing. Then I'm coming out. And then again, I'm not doing the sadhana, and I'm getting caught up. And then one day while sitting, I got so frustrated, why this is happening? I cried. I prayed to the Lord. I wrote down, I came back from work. I wrote down what could be the possible reason, etc., etc. But I could not come to the answer. Why this is happening? And why this flux of going, being in meditation, and yet when I stop all that, again the vices catch me. And that night I went to bed totally frustrated, and someone just the weekend before, they had given me a novel type Bhagavatam, Srimad Bhagavatam in Hindi. But the photograph was beautiful. I used to stay away from books. I didn't like reading too many books. And this was this thick book. So I said, forget it, keep it. Photograph is nice. Who will read it? And that night, I was tossing and turning and thinking, what could be the possible solution to this problem? Because now I'm at it. I caught it by its neck that I want to find a solution. And in that frustration, I just put the lamp on and I got the book. I looked at Sri Krishna, beautiful photograph, and I started speaking to him. And it's like I went into meditation, just lying down in the bed, looking at the photograph, open-eyed meditation. And suddenly, a deep voice from within spoke to me. You stupid fool, till now you have been doing the sadhana. Have you ever done the sadhana for my sake? I have done this, I have done the pranayama, I have done the kundalini sadhana, I have overcome the vices, I had go into meditation. But when have you ever offered it to me? When have you ever done the sadhana for my sake? Oh my God. I completely broke down at that time. It was so true. And from there, then I said, now from today onwards, I will only take your name and no more sadhana. And that night I did not sleep, only the Lord's name. And I continued 24/7. I used to take it as long as I remember. So if sleep comes, sleep comes. I don't know when I slept. I don't know when I got up. I don't know when I'm going to work, but it went on for almost 6, 7, 8 months. And in those 6, 7, 8 months, again, all the yogic experiences happened. But this time, due to the focus, not because I was doing the focus, it was by the grace of the divine. And then deep silence, about which there was no doubt. And one day, when I was deep in meditation, I heard the chanting of Om. And I went and asked my grandfather, are you chanting Om loudly? He said, no, I'm not. And I could hear it. 3 days, it won't stop. And third, fourth day, came to sit down after getting up, and the Om stopped. It was inside, outside, everywhere. It was strange. And then it all converted. A huge, jaise kams ne suna hoga na, kams heard that your mrityu will be by the eighth son of Devaki. Similarly, the sound came from inside, which I could hear everywhere, that study the scriptures, study the scriptures, shastra padho, 3 times it came. Who spoke, I don't know. But that was the sound that I heard. It could be the inner voice, it could be whatever it was, God's guidance. And within 2-3 months, everything happened so fast that I was in the Himalayas. I bought one-way ticket to Himalayas, and I came to Himalayas. Just before coming to Himalayas, someone called me just 1 month, 15-20 days before. Hey, you are going to Himalayas. I heard you are my sister's friend. She said, why don't you come and listen to one lecture? Someone is talking on Ramayana. So I went, oh my God, I always knew Ramayana had some secrets, but what are those secrets? here Swamiji is telling Aranyakanda was going on, sannyas, that is his sannyas period, and 6 days continuously I continued listening to the lectures, evening, morning, then Kaivalya Upanishad, Atma Bodh, and it was like I have come home. And he, one day that Master Swamiji told, why don't you come to the ashram? I said, okay. And he fed me dosa and everything. Then I asked him, do you know any master who can teach me Bhagavad Gita? He says, what am I doing, man? I said, oh, if he's saying that, what am I doing? Then he will catch me. I don't want to get caught up in any organization. I don't want to get caught up with any person. I want to just study the study the scriptures. And in this manner, he said, anyway, if you are not, if you're going to Himalayas, why don't you go to Siddhavadi? And that was the 3rd of August was the Samadhi day of Chinmayanandji. So I landed up there, and there the work was going on, the program was going on, the brahmacharis were getting initiated into brahmachari diksha, those who had studied before the previous batch. And Swami Anubhavananji was there, and that's where I met him, and then went with him to Chardham after that. And then it's the story continues.
So you studied under Anubhavananda ji?
Yes. Okay. And that time he was the Acharya there.
At the Chinmaya Mission?
Ha.
Okay. So that's a wonderful encounter, I must say. I can recall so many Upanishad Vakyas which reflect directly to the, you know, the journey of yours. Vidyate Hridaya Granthihi. So it just happens instantaneously. I can relate like that.
And without ever having studied the scriptures. So when I went to study the scriptures in the ashram, it was like, hey, I know this. Because whatever was going on, this mind did not have the articulation or the words to express what it was experiencing. And it was like, hey, it was whatever the Upanishads are telling, Bhagavad Gita is telling, the crux of it. That is what was going on.
Thank you, Swamiji, for that. And Swamiji, you have been teaching for so many years now. You mentioned, yes, 22 years. And you also teach Yoga Sutras, Vedanta, Upanishads. And along with that, you also teach Santa Gnaneshwari. And it is very less common in the sampradaya that we have seen. It might be my, this thing. But I have not seen much teaching of the Gnaneshwar's Gnaneshwari. But I have heard that it's a wonderful commentary on Gita. Could you shed some light on it? How
Gnaneshwari is the bhavartha. It's a young boy of 12 years old, by the instruction of his teacher, his elder brother, who is Nivritti Nath, his Guru Maharaj, he instructs, hey, child, Jnana, now you tell the people the secrets of Bhagavad Gita. And this young 12-year-old boy, whose parents have gone, only these four brothers and sisters are there, Nivritti Nath, Jnandev Maharaj, Sopandev, and Muktabai. And he starts, never studied any scriptures. And it is, he is talking to common man. That time, only pandits were the beholders of the scriptures. Nobody could study Sanskrit or speak Sanskrit. They said, oh, we are the only pandits can. And here was a young boy who was defying them. And the story went through whatever you must have, everyone has seen, heard that story of Gnaneshwar Maharaj. But it is a bhavatmic approach of this young boy towards the Bhagavad Gita. And the beauty of this commentary or his speech is, as he's talking to common people and the pandits of that time, but more so for the common people, the farmers, the carpenter, the mochi, everyone was allowed to come. And he is using innumerable number of examples. For every verse, there are, which you don't find in our Shankar Bhashya, you don't get only Rajju and Sarpa. But here, he takes whatever is going on in this world, he picks up examples like it's nobody's business to instill the principle to the common man's simple mind. And the teaching is exactly like whatever Shankaracharya ji is saying, same tenets are there, but no not too much logic, but coming straight to the point, and approach is through the heart.
So it's not a commentary, but it's a bhava, like a retelling of the entire Bhagavad Gita.
Yeah, you can say that, but every verse he is giving his own, like you are asking me a question, instead of telling you a sutra or something, I'm giving you a explanation. So he's also giving explanation, but coming from the heart rather than logic.
Correct.
So it's a good balance after taking, having studied Shankar Bhashya with Swamiji and reading the Bhavartha Deepika. It's called Bhavartha Deepika.
Okay.
So it was very, very fascinating. And right now I'm taking Amrut Anubhav, on which Anubhavananji did a detailed commentary is there on every verse. He did his PhD on it, I think, from some Netherlands university. But it is a text, it is a writing by Jnaneshwar Maharaj on his experience of realization just before he took Sanjeevani Samadhi.
Okay.
So that was his final conclusion. And it's absolutely, you have to read it.
So Jnaneshwar Maharaj has composed two works then, or are there other works?
There is Tsangde Pasashti. In those days, 760 years, 40, 50 years ago, there was a great saint by the name of Tsangde Maharaj, who was 1400 years old. 1400, by doing Kaya Kalp, and all the Siddhis, the entire nature is at his fingertips. And he hears that there is some great saint, young boy by the name of Jnaneshwar Maharaj. So he says, okay, what should I write to him? Should I write my dear child? But they say he's a Mahatma. So should I say Pujya Swamiji? So he gets confused. 1400 years old man, Swami, is getting confused. So he sends him a blank paper. And Jnaneshwar Maharaj, when he gets that blank paper, he's very happy. And he gives him 60, Pasashti means 65. He writes 65 verses, which is pure Vedanta, as a reply. And the moment he gets this letter, this 1400-year-old man, he immediately rushes to Jnaneshwar Maharaj. And he comes with his whole paraphernalia, all the devotees in his presence, all the animals, enemies of each other. They are all friends, the snake, the tigers, the elephants, everything coming together. And someone comes and tells Jnaneshwar Maharaj, he's brushing his teeth in the morning with his brother, sister, sitting on a wall. That wall is still there in Alandi. So, and they say, hey, Tsangde Maharaj is coming. He says, oh, we should not make an elderly person like that to wait for us. We should go and meet him. So their younger sister, she was only 6 years old. She says, Dada, why we should not delay. Take this wall only there. And he just tells the wall, and the wall flies, and they land in front of him. And then that was one text, Tsangde Pasashti. Pasaidan is there. Amrut Anubhav is there. Bhavartha Deepika, which is Bhagavad Gita, the commentary that is there. Yeah, so four I know. If there is anything else, I'll have to check.
Okay. I think these are very less explored in the teachings also.
Yes, because not everyone thinks, first thing is language. Nobody had written a commentary in English or Hindi on these texts. Bhavartha Deepika, the Bhagavad Gita commentary, now you can get it in Hindi also.
But the original is in Marathi.
Marathi, very old Marathi, 700 years old Marathi.
Okay.
All of these texts are in Marathi.
Okay.
But Anubhavananji, he wrote the, gave lectures in Thane on Amrut Anubhav, I think, in Thane, I think, but on Amrut Anubhav. And that then came out as a book. And I tell you, after that, you will not read anything.
Thank you, Swamiji. And yeah, you mentioned about how your encounter with Bhagavan Sri Krishna happened and how you meditated upon him. But, you know, Swamiji, like, what is the role of bhakti in Vedanta? Like many other Vedantins tell that the Advaita Vedantins don't have any place for devotion or bhakti. What is your opinion on that?
I don't know what Vedantins talk about. I don't put myself in a box that I am a Vedantin or I am a devotee or I am everything. And if you just heard how the scriptures pulled me to them, it was not without devotion to the Lord. That's my personal example, my personal experience, that I would not have come to Vedanta if I had not purified myself and fallen in love with the Lord and his name. So if I don't know who are these people who are saying that bhakti is not required, but bhakti expands your mind. Bhakti surrender brings about the dissolution of the individuality. Because without bhakti, how you are going to merge into that infinite that you are? Intellectualization is not going to help you merge. Intellectualization is going to maintain the I. We can keep using words, we can keep using logic, we can keep you chanting I say something and 100 verses you can probably chant. And you or anyone else. But that is the path of knowledge, isn't it? If you're talking about path of knowledge, if knowledge is not concluding in surrender, if knowledge is not concluding in love for the entire, then we have gone the wrong way. Correct. And so also for a devotee, if the devotion and the bhakti is not concluding in knowledge, then that person is going the wrong way. It's both ways. They're the two wings.
Correct. I have heard this phrase that parabhakti and paravidya are same and they are not different at all.
They're same, yes. I won't know the shloka to confirm that, but
based on your experience, we can come to that conclusion.
Yeah.
Thank you, Swamiji. And Swamiji, you have done so many pilgrimages in India and you have frequently done the Kailash pilgrimage. And could you tell us what is the significance of Kailash pilgrimage and how this helps in an individual spiritual pursuit?
Kailash pilgrimage, the first one was my wish. Other times that I have gone on pilgrimages, they have not been my desire. But living in Australia, people looking at the photographs or listening to me about the grandness of the of India or of Kailash for that matter, then I do not advertise or nor do I have a desire to go there. But people come together, Swamiji, let's go, we'll organize. Okay, let's organize. And I don't mind going. How long are we going to keep talking? Every year, some pilgrimage gets organized by itself, not because I want it, but it happens. So Jyotirlingas, or last year, just before the COVID began, we went to Dwarka, Girnar. We climbed 10,000 steps of Girnar, then went to Ayodhya, went to Vrindavan, Haridwar. So 1 month tour was there, and then we came back. Something has to happen in life, no?
Correct.
So if this happened, but not because of my will, it happened because of those who wanted to go.
And, what about your first pilgrimage, Swamiji? Could you tell us about that? Your first pilgrimage, okay, to Kailash.
Oh, that time, that was in 2002. And that time, have you been to Kailash?
No, Swamiji.
No. In 2002, there were no roads. You would go in a four-wheel drive, a Toyota Land Cruiser, from Nepal. We went from Nepal. Every time we have gone from Nepal, because from India only the Indian citizens can go. And that too, it's a potluck. Here, we make our own group and we keep it small so that, and we have enough Sherpas so that at least one Sherpa between three people to help them. And that way we used to go, or we have gone. The first time when we went, we were about 9 of us, out of which 4 were the Nepalese royal family princesses, and we three, 4 were men, and one gentleman there had, he was the husband of one of the princesses, so they say. I don't know all the details of that, and he organized, and I went in with them, and someone out of the blue, one person who had come with us, he said, "Swamiji, you don't worry, I'll take care of you." He paid for it, and it happened. But no roads.
Okay.
We were driving on the riverbeds. We had to cross the suddenly the rivers would flood. Suddenly the water will go away. So many things used to happen, and there were no toilets. Now there are toilets. Now they have built buildings, and there is flushed water and everything at the base of Kailash, where the accommodation has been built in Darchen. But not in those times. We had to go outside, take your lota, and out into the bush, or they used to put up a small tent, and our Sherpas, who were the lifesavers, they will cook up a fresh meal, breakfast, lunch, dinner. They were our mothers. They used to take care of our nourishment like anything. And that time, by God's grace, 2 times it happened. And that is, Lord Shiva allowed us to do the outer parikrama, and then we did the inner parikrama also. Inner parikrama is Nandi parikrama. And that, in that you go up to 21,000 feet. And we did that without oxygen.
Okay.
And the Chinese military was not allowing. So in the middle of the night at 4 o'clock in the morning, at 8 o'clock at night, we sneaked into the hills and crossed over and completed our journey till next night. And that was absolutely out of this world. At a physical level, yes, and mental level. Just to be in the presence of Lord Kailash, I'm talking just like I'm seeing you, I'm seeing Lord Kailash, I'm standing in front of him. The third eye, which you see in the Kailash, in the middle of the Kailash mountain, you're just standing in front. It's ready to absorb you, pull you into it. And you swoon out of the grace or lack of oxygen, or mind cannot think there, God knows. But you are in his lap. And we climbed, where, how many? Six of us, we climbed up out of the 9. And the Buddhist, there are 7 stupas there. They say the 7 rishis, our rishis. They call it stupas. And the Tibetans, when they go there, they take out one piece of stone from Kailash to say that we came here, and then they go out, go down. But for us, it was a blessing. It was like this. It's like a cave. Huge, almost 300 meter long.
Okay.
200 meter long. So this became a safe place. And we were sitting there, we chanted Nirvana Shatkam, we chanted Purusha Suktam, we chanted Rudram. I was there almost for half an hour. They say you should not be sitting there at all because you can get into the oxygen, lack of oxygen, no?
Correct.
But we chanted, and those who were with me, they sat in meditation. And then what to do? We put our hand out. It is like this. So if the hand is coming out, the snow is melting from the top and you get direct Tirtha from Kailash. I tell you, here it is coming as a story, but that time it just invigorated us. We were so exhausted, so tired, but that one sip of the Tirth, which is coming from the top of Kailash, because Kailash is 23,000 feet high. We were at 21,000 feet, sitting in his lap. And there we are getting the Tirth from him, directly from him. Just the mental imagination, just listening itself, my mind is listening what I'm saying, and it's gone into that zone, you know. And again, the next time when I went in 2012, again we had, but now Chinese government doesn't allow it.
Okay. Listening to it only is so much, you know, of a mind-boggling thing that you receive the Tirtham from Lord Shiva himself.
Lord Shiva himself.
The Amrita Bindu itself.
Yes. And there they say, there you can see there is a small triangle, that it is a door, and every 62 or 64 years that door opens, and many, many Mahatmas are living, meditating in their subtle body there. So the saying goes. And when that door opens on Mahashivratri day, all of these rush into the to become one with Lord Shiva.
Wonderful, Swamiji. Thank you.
This
so
is
much.
The yogic parables. But coming from where we are coming, we understand that Kailash, Varanasi, all the Jyotirlingas are within us only. But that doesn't stop us from enjoying and being in the presence. That same infinite reality is itself manifesting as this creation, if you take it that way. It's in and through the creation.
Correct.
The upadan karan, the material out of which the whole creation is made. It cannot be outside it. And among the mountains, what better place to go other than Kailash or Arunachala? Same experience you get in Arunachala also.
Correct.
Have you been to Arunachala?
Yeah, I have been to Arunachala.
Yes. Yes.
And you also went to Manasa Sarovara later?
Yeah, we took bath there. And many people experienced some things, the lights and the swans. We saw swans once.
Okay.
And but for out of my 8 or 9 trips to Kailash, people used to say, I saw this, I saw lights, I saw that. I said, it's all mental imagination, because I was not seeing anything. But last time when I went, 2019, that time early in the morning, the Chinese government had stopped everyone from taking dip in the Mansarovar.
Okay.
You can't take. You have to take a bucket and then take. I said, okay, all that is, we will do it for your sake. But we got up at 3:30 in the morning. And we went to the pitch darkness.
That must have been freezing then.
Well, who cares, man? And pitch darkness, nobody can see. Took off our clothes in the darkness, quickly jumped into it, came out, and I was sitting there on the banks in meditation at 4:30 in the morning, just for some time. It's quite cold. It was quite cold. And I don't know, it is because of the cold, or it was because of the chilled waters, or it is because of lack of oxygen, or it is grace of God. That day, I saw what other people were seeing, the lights in the sky coming in towards the Mansarovar Lake. But that was after 8 trips in the last yatra.
Okay, sir.
So I said, oh, this is what it is. And in the end, you know, I don't want to put anything to it. It's an imagination or it is a divine vision. I got no idea.
Thank you so much for that wonderful encounter, Swamiji.
Yeah.
Yeah. You have spoken so much about individual spiritual journey. You have mentioned how bhakti, yoga, meditation helps a lot. Could you shed light on what qualities are expected out of a person in spiritual pursuit? How one should conduct himself? What is expected out of him or her?
It may be generalized, but here what I see or what I have come to the conclusion is everyone wants to practice yoga, everyone wants to practice pranayam, everyone wants to sit in meditation, everyone wants to study the scriptures, and eventually they get frustrated in all these because they have not done the first part, which is the yama niyama in life. Living a righteous life, living a life of aparigraha, asteya, brahmacharya, and all those. So in short, yama is, what is my quality of interaction with the world is yama. So and how do I interact with the world? Thought, word, and deed, actions. So are my thought, word, and deed disturbing the world, or am I getting disturbed by the actions of other people or thoughts of other people or words of other people? If this is not sorted, how can one go and do yoga? They can be very flexible at the body level, but they can never reach the ultimate. Unless we have not, learned to keep the world at bay, which is only through yama. And then niyama is, how do you interact with yourself? Because our mind is never leaving us. So our habits are never leaving us. Our default settings are never leaving us. So you practice the niyam, then automatically discipline comes in. And if a person has done yama niyama diligently in his daily life, then the further steps, they may happen, they may not happen, it doesn't matter. Because you are there. If yama niyama is matured, then Patanjali Maharaj says, what is asan? Asan is not 64 animal asans. There's no human asan, only shavasan. Then what is asan? Sthira sukham asan, isn't it?
Yes.
He who is sitting in happiness is the true asan. If you do the first two parts, yama, niyama, sincerely, automatically the next stage, which is asan, this is his definition, not my definition. But what is the world lost in? Only flexibility of the body. Our Anubhavananji used to say, don't twist your body, straighten the mind.
Correct. Yeah.
So that is what it is. And that straightening of the mind is remaining, becoming proof, and disturbance proof from the world and also from this prakriti. What is body, breath, mind, intellect? That is the niyam. And automatically then, when everything is under niyantran, then happiness automatically ensues because personality gets integrated as a result.
Correct.
And the rest is all, if you read Patanjali Yoga Sutra, after the three sutras, you don't need to read the rest of the 569 sutras. Adha yoganushasanam chitta vritti nirodha iti yoga, which in Vedanta we don't accept. But then the next part is that chitta vritti meanings do not be destroyed by anything in this world. And the next is tadadrashtu swarupavasthanam. Now, after tadadrashtu swarupavasthanam, what is more required to be done? Then rest of the sutras are there because the stupid student doesn't understand tadadrashtu swarupavasthanam. So the commentary begins. What are the types of mind and what are the types of samadhi? That also he doesn't understand. Then he says, oh, Ishwar pranidhanaha. So you take the support of Ishwar. That also he doesn't understand. Then in the second chapter comes the Ashtanga Yoga.
Could you elaborate on the third sutra that you mentioned, Swamiji? A few words on it.
Drashtuhu swarupe avasthanam.
Correct, Swamiji.
What can be talked about it, man? It has to happen.
A few words, Swamiji, for the benefit of our audience.
It has to happen. Until and unless the individual does not become disturbance proof from the world and his own mind, till then tadadrashtuhu swarupavasthanam will not take place. That same tadadrashtuhu swarupavasthanam is who am I? From Ramana Maharishi's, that is his approach. Tada, then, drashtuhu, see, swarupa, your essence. And he is asking, who am I? He is also going after the I. He is also looking, he is saying, drashtuhu. So look at who is the person who has brought about chitta vritti nirodaha. Yeah. So this is not possible until unless we have become a disturbance proof. Disturbance proof from outside and disturbance proof from within. And this is not something today. Many people are inspired by who am I inquiry. But I believe, in my opinion, okay, it's only opinion, my experience also, that who am I must come as a result of purification or disturbance proofness. Who am I must erupt in our bosom as a result of our urgency to meet ourselves. But when who am I is asked because we have read a book, we ask koham because we have been following Ramana Maharishi without having given up our attachment. We want the wife on our one side and children on the other. And we want one part of our mind to be continuously indulging in the investments. And then I will live a balanced life. This tadadrashtu swarupavasthanam or who am I, it is not for a person who is living in that manner. Yes, equanimity is required, but not the way the overindulgence in the worldly, then it will not happen. But when it happens as a result of purification, in the initial stages, once it catches you, who am I? Or once it catches you that you, because remember what I said, chitta vritti nirodha, it is not cessation of all thoughts. Because mind's job is to think. How can you make it not think? We never say drishya vritti, drishya nirodha for the eyes. Eyes continue to see. They are not disturbed by any object. Ears continue to listen. They are not disturbed by any object. Tongue continues to taste all the different flavors. It is not disturbed by anything. Then why the mind must get disturbed by various thoughts? And what is that? Appearance of thoughts or disappearance of thoughts, isn't it?
Correct.
If eyes are not disturbed by presence or absence of form or colors, and so also the various senses, then why should we make this and our business, or we think this way, that mind is distorted because of thoughts. It is its job. Let it think. And if you catch this, if we catch this, that mind's job is to think, but I am the observer of it. Now you, if we have fallen into that disposition, and automatically, who am I? Who is this one who's observing? It is inevitable. It is inevitable.
Correct.
And that is what is told here, tada drashtu swarupe avasthanam. Don't go into niruddha bhumi. Don't go into blankness. Don't go into void. Because when people are doing chitta vritti nirodha, they are literally taking it. That's why Vedanta is required in our life to re-understand these terms. That will become like a hit out or go out. Thoughts are disturbing, remove the thoughts, then I am with myself. That is not how life is. My way or the highway. It's not that way. One must have an intelligent approach towards it. And for that, only what has worked in our life and the various sadhakas which I see is, and this is what I keep stressing, forget about the inquiry. First concentrate on, okay, do the inquiry, come to satsang, listen to, do some sadhana, chanting of om or nam japa or whatever you are doing. But that must percolate into your daily life. You are going to work, you are going to gym, you are going talking with your family or you are single or you are a bachelor, whatever you are doing in life, you must remain disturbance proof. Until unless that does not happen, it's expression, you know, if whatever sadhana we are doing, whatever sadhana, even shravanam, if that is not translating into a decoupling from the world, that is yama, and decoupling from this prakriti, body, breath, mind, intellect, that is niyama. Till then, the tada drashtuhu will not happen. And that is our natural state. All these things we have only gathered. No, all this you already know.
Thank you, Swamiji, for that wonderful exposition. And Swamiji, you're also the president of Yoga Vedanta Association in Australia. How did association conceptualize? What are the activities that are carried out in the association?
Yoga Vedanta was conceptualized by Swami Anubhavananji when he came the first time or second time. So we needed to invite him to Australia. So under the banner of Yoga Vedanta, again, Yoga Vedanta, yoga as well as Vedanta, knowledge plus practical application. Not only yoga, not only knowledge. It has to be, if you take it from, yeah, so that was the whole idea. We are talking about Yoga Vedanta. So that's how it came about, and under its banner, we did all our activities. So here, all my classes are held under its banner at the moment. But people don't know Yoga Vedanta, they know only Swami Paramananda, because I don't talk too much about organization or anything, because there's just under its name, we invite, if I'm doing some retreat or something, I do it under its name. All activities are happening under its banner, but it's a bigger ghost than our individual ghost.
Are you currently conducting any workshops or retreats, Swamiji?
Yeah, every 3 months, 2 months, 3-4 months, we have a retreat. So last three, four retreats, I've been addressing the Sri Ramana Gita. So we have come up to chapter 12. So in the midst of the COVID, we had a break of almost 3 weeks. So someone booked a retreat place in about 300 kilometers from Melbourne, and about 16 of us came together, lived together, bushwalked together, trekked together, and every day three lectures on Ramana Gita. So after 1 year, we had come out of our houses. And similarly, there is a Christian monastery just close by here, about half an hour away from my place in the hills. So usually I hire it for a weekend. Sometimes usually I do a week long retreat in the new year. And usually sometimes I take one complete Upanishad or something. I don't know. So it hasn't happened last 2 years. So let's see when that chance comes next time. Otherwise we do, because retreat becomes a bit expensive affair. You have to give accommodation and organize food and this and that. Then I take here talks in Hindi at a Fiji temple. So it's a big place, it can accommodate about 70, 80 people. So they also want it to be used. So I do my retreats there. It's free, anyone can come. And one or two people take the responsibility, organize some food, and we have the Ramana Gita and Kaivalya Upanishad, and some quite a last 4 or 5 years that is also taking place. Then in Sydney, I'm taking Sri Ramana Upanishad. That is going on for last 3 years, apart from individual lectures when I go there. So these things go on.
Thank you so much. We are also
they keep me busy. People keep me busy.
Yes, Swamiji. Yeah.
And what better way to live than every day satsang, you know?
Yes, yes. Satsangatva and nisangatvam.
Nisangatvam, yes. Every day there is a satsang.
Correct. We are almost towards the end of the session. I just wanted to know, what is your final advice to spiritual seekers, like serious seekers who want to study Vedanta and want to discover the real nature of the self? What is your advice to them and also to the society?
When you say real seekers, do you mean to say rest of the humanity is not seeking? They are also seeking.
Yeah, yeah.
So just because someone has studied scriptures or someone has started yoga does not mean that they are real seekers.
No, many
seekers. Pardon me?
Serious seekers.
Yeah, yeah, serious only. Yeah. Many sadhus and sannyasis are there. Not sadhus, sannyasis are there. They started off with real seeking. Now they have got big families called ashrams and disciples. And they are lost in collecting and building more and more buildings. So big portfolio. So what do we understand by real seeking? You know, truth. One is, don't be too serious about spirituality. When we become too serious, we are moving away from the path. In the name of vratas and anushthanas and all that is required. If it is coming from within, good. But it must come naturally. Just like hunger comes naturally. A hiccup comes naturally. Similarly, spiritual evolution is also natural. Spiritual evolution is also natural. Everything in our life that is taking place is only to help us grow spiritually. But we are stuck. Ki I am a Vedanti, or I am a devotee, or I am a yogi, or we get into cults, we get into organizations, but we never get into the self. That is the problem. We get into everything else, but we never get into the self. So don't be too serious about it. Make it a joyful interaction with yourself. Only then it will start unfolding. You know, becoming too serious. Our Swamiji has a motto, be happy. Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma. If ultimately we have to be happy, why not start now? Why take spirituality? Oh my God, I have to control my senses. Oh my God, I have to control my mind. Oh my God, I have to do this pratha and that pratha. I have to punish my mind. What are you? All those are rakshasa qualities, asura qualities. Fighting with your because whatever you do, whatever control you exercise at the prakriti level, asuras are also doing the same. So if you are spiritual, our attention must be on the atmic principle, and atma is ananda swarup. So express that ananda in your life. Why become so serious about every damn thing? Become gambhir when you are giving lecture, talking, or discussing. You must have a happy disposition. And then when we are happy, we are creative. When we are happy, life, because Atma is Ananda Swarup, and when that happiness is expressing in your thought, word, speech, in your actions, everywhere, you are there. You don't need to get anywhere. You are there. That will be revealed. So, yeah. With that, hope.
Yes, thank you so much, so much for that wonderful teaching. From the entire team of Advaita Academy, I thank you immensely for agreeing and coming on our platform, and you have given us this wonderful interview session. Thank you so much once again. And also from my colleague, Abhinand, I also send his pranams to you. Thank you so much.
Hariom. Take care.
Thank you.
All the best.